Today on The Point TV.
That the woman's reaction seems to come from a place of compassion and empathy, and what can I do to help you, even if I feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
The reality is we put a lot of essence and value on the spoken word, and we let go behind all of the things behind the spoken word.
That's why I don't have an attachment. It's like, it's up to you to take the action. Here's the help, whether it's advice, whether it's tools, resources, and now it's up to you to take the action.
Making a difference, it's my purpose, it's what I'm here to do. I'm here to make the world a better place.
And later.
So really what you've got is a whole heap of good answers to the wrong question.
God, give me the right question. Yeah.
You should be asking, why do people continue to help when it's detrimental to someone else?
All this and more on The Point TV.
Welcome to The Point TV today. Boy, have we got a panel of are they experts or do they just have a say? If you have been following us and you have been watching about this huge topic around the need to help people, what we're here to do today is we're either here to see whether people have this innate feeling, this generosity spirit, of whether they really want to help people. So with me, I'm not going to introduce everyone. They will get their turn. But I do want to first start off with welcome everyone. How are you all doing? All happy for this great Sunday?
Yes.
Never happier.
As happy as they should be.
Can't wait to help.
They all really want to help me with my feelings, don't they? So let me first start. Jeff, I do want to talk to you first because I think you're one of the maybe few people in here that have got some experience and some knowledge about your history and your background. But I want to ask you this question. Let's first define the word help. What is it?
I'll go with a layman's term because it's probably easiest. For most people see help as someone's got a better resources, they've got better knowledge, they've got the ability to go and work with someone who does not have those resources. They see as being depleted in those areas. So usually someone will help if they see an area of need or they're requested to by someone that feels they have an area of need, and then they'll jump in and trying to help.
See, I think most of the people that I've been dealing with, they're either, you know, coaches, they're spiritual people, they're people who have this wonderment about their skills and knowledge, but they also have this need to offer help. And I'll give you a very quick example is that I may have written something up on Facebook not that long ago, and with my sarcasm, for the people who do know me, I'm quite maybe a little bit sarcastic, but I will get a person who doesn't know me, they'll just write something and go, "Are you okay?" What if I was to turn to that person and say, actually, no, I'm not? What happens in that case then? Are they the authority to ask that question without having any skill or resources behind them?
We haven't got enough time to go into when you ask someone...
But what I'm asking is why...
What happens is it fires... As soon as you ask the question, you show a need or someone sees that there's a need, it fires this...
Empathy?
Some sort of... Well, not just empathy. It fires a whole sequence of things inside someone. Usually it's about their motivations, their own conditioning, their own self-drive. So when you talk about someone's need to help, what they're feeling is really their own experiences and so forth coming through, saying, if I don't help this person, then it reflects bad on me, or...
Oh, so it's about you.
Yeah, there's no such thing as compassion.
So it's about you.
There's not instant compassion.
Oh, so
what we're looking
to the point. So it's all about you. It's actually not about me.
What you're looking at is self-interest. Makes me feel good.
You can relate to that.
Yeah, I mean, basically, it's really interesting. When you say to somebody, how are you today? You expect the answer, I'm fine, thanks, how are you? And the second that somebody says, actually, I'm feeling really bad today, the instinct is to walk away. You don't know how to handle that. And it's really interesting what you're saying as well. I honestly think that 95% of people, if you say I'm having a bad day, I'll go, oh my God, well, how do I handle this? I've no idea how to handle this. That's the wrong answer. That's not what I expected.
So seriously, what gives them the right to ask the question?
But I see it as maybe you just need to hear that someone cares, and that might be just enough to say, are you okay? And it just showing you that there is someone there.
My problem with that, Kerry, and I totally get where you're coming from, is that you're asking that question, what if I turned around, and God help me if I ever said anything like this, God will help me. And if I said, actually, Kerry, no, I'm not okay. I can't stop beating my wife.
I would say play her at something that she's good at. That was funny, by the way. I'm sorry.
But on a serious point, what if I was to turn around and say, I'm actually feeling quite suicidal?
Well, I suppose that would be my choice then. Do I contact police or go to someone? If I don't have the ability to help you, then maybe I can put someone in your direction that can help you.
Tough one.
It's interesting, isn't it, that the woman's reaction seems to come from a place of compassion and empathy and what can I do to help you? Even if I feel uncomfortable, maybe I know someone who can help you. It's a nurturing sort of instant reaction, whereas the men's reaction is, well, hang on a minute, what's in this for me? How can I make
Not necessarily. No. I disagree with that. What I would say is if Gerald said that to me, said, Mike, actually I'm feeling suicidal, first of all, I would ask him why he was feeling suicidal.
But your reaction to it just now was a joke.
But I'm actually dealing with the question now, because when I made the funny, it wasn't actually a joke, regarding him. He didn't say about committing suicide then. If somebody said to me, I'm feeling suicidal, I'd say, actually, okay, why are you feeling suicidal? Have you thought of calling Lifeline?
No,
because they are the experts.
And a person who's feeling that, and Jeff, you can probably jump in there again, a person who's feeling that is not going to say, yeah, actually, you're quite right. I've got my mind now intact. And I'm thinking on a logical level, yes, I'll get on the phone and dial 000 because that'll help me. I'm not thinking like that.
Well, you're not thinking at all if you're feeling suicidal.
I'm not thinking at all. David, jump in.
Yeah, I'm just thinking on that. If someone comes to you and says, and you say to them the gesture of, how are you today? It's really just, hello. They really don't want to know how you're feeling. They just want to say hello. So that becomes that. But if you then say, actually, I'm feeling really bad. I feel like crap.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what's going on? Well, you're right, you know, and then the conversation starts because obviously the person is in a need, they're reaching out. You don't have to do anything other than just be that sounding board. And from experience, that's all it needs. It doesn't need anything else.
What do you
just
do, though? If you say to somebody, and like you're in the supermarket, and somebody says, how are you going? That normal like we do in Australia, how are you going?
Yeah, sensational.
And we just expect a hello back. Yeah. Somebody says to you, I'm not too bad.
Yeah, cool.
How do you respond to someone who says not to
do I know them intimately or do I know them
I ask
from
them to give
time?
Me 10 things they're grateful for. Because you
in a conversation in the shop?
Absolutely.
Oh, I'd walk away.
No, I ask them.
Yeah, I also walk away.
I do it all the time. Somebody says to me, not too bad.
Excellent.
It triggers me to say, give me 10 things you're grateful for.
Yeah, but again...
You can't go through life
but in that situation,
just not too bad.
But in that situation, they may just be not too bad. You know, how are you feeling today? Not too bad.
And it's a shitty way to live.
But that's
opinion,
not what
isn't
that's
it?
The question is about, really, is it?
No, you said when people are asking for help.
It depends on your relationship with that person.
That's right.
So people who have a more intimate relationship with someone are more inclined to actually act and help, because when we look at our relationships with people around us, there's about 7 different ways that we will initiate help-seeking or helping behaviours or initiate ways that we assist people. And they are based on our social status, whether we can actually gain better social status out of it, whether we our intimate relationship, whether we're looking for a mate and whether that person is someone we want to impress or not.
A status with somebody I meet in the supermarket. When somebody says to me, I say, hey, don't they go, oh, not too bad. Every time at a petrol station and so anywhere, if someone says those words to me,
so why can't you walk
I will
away?
Stop, because it makes me feel like this person is in a situation.
So your self-interest says
no,
that you need
because
to go
at the
on.
End of every single time I've done that with people, do you know what's happened? I've then said to them, "So how's your day?"
Yeah.
And they said, "It's really good, thank you." Yeah. So I've made them feel slightly better.
Correct.
But about the day that they're happy, they're having. Then that's fantastic.
So within you is a dissonance that you can't walk away from that person without thinking that you've actually made their day happy.
I do it mostly to embarrass my daughter, to be honest with you, because she hates me doing it while I'm there.
But
you can't walk away
because there's something... If you walk away, that dissonance inside, it creates a problem for you if you walk away. So we either help because we have an issue with it and we need to alleviate that issue, or if walking away will create an issue for us. So
is there a problem that if you want to help somebody...
I never said it was a problem.
Okay, so there's a dissonance that you've got to help make sure somebody else is having a better day than just a not-too-bad day.
So, yep, that's it. The next step up from this is what we're talking about, because like Gerald's quite happy here because this is a lot of conversation going on, but really what it comes down to is what we're talking about in that help-seeking, that help issue. You're saying that my helping is effective and it's helping people and it's a good thing, and then we're saying helping is a bad thing. There's a limit in between. So at what point does your helping then become interfering?
I think the thing that with all of those things that you're talking about, it's the English language, and the English language is confusing in itself anyway. So if this person says not too bad, that could be just a genuine way that they say, how are you, or
absolutely.
Hello. Because their upbringing says, their mum and dad said, how are you going? Yeah, not too bad. And then they just say it. So in a communication in the shopping centre where you don't know really someone that well, and they go, yeah, not too bad. You go, well, okay, that's fine, because their body language and their tone indicates that they're not too bad.
But there's that saying, isn't there? The words that you speak
if someone says,
are the emotions that you have.
Well, not really, because the body language suggests a whole lot of different things. So if someone says to you, yeah, not too bad, you think, oh, they're feeling good. Their words are irrelevant. If they go, yeah, I'm feeling sensational today, you know, you go, well that's, again, completely different word. So in my experience, and again, my opinion, because I won't go down that path about things that everybody has.
Sounds good.
Their opinions anyway, but the reality is we put a lot of essence and value on the spoken word, and we let go behind all of the things behind the spoken word.
So
my experience.
What I want to ask is this fulfilling an innate need for you to satisfy yourself that you've thought at some level that you've actually contributed to this person's well-being? Kerry?
I don't... people that have a need to help people, I don't feel that's the right place to come from, because I feel that's like gratifying the ego, and people like that can sometimes have a need to be needed. So it kind of sets them on a false sense of purpose, where if you come from a place of love, there's nothing that's required from that. You just give freely without expectation of someone else. So,
interesting. Can I sort of jump in there? It was almost like you were talking about me for a minute, because I do a voluntary radio show on a Monday. Obviously, it's voluntary. The clue's entitled. I don't get paid for it. But I do it because I enjoy it and I get a lot out of it. But does that make me a bad person because I'm doing it for the fun of it? I don't actually think about... I love having people on the show for a chat, but I don't think, wow, I'm increasing their quality of life, I'm helping them. I think, this would be interesting on the show. Does that make me rely on my ego?
No, makes you a bad person, but there's...
But that's the reason I do it, so I'm being honest. I do it because I enjoy doing it. The fact I don't get paid for it is irrelevant.
Yeah. What's your payoff? What are you getting out of it?
Huge massaging of the ego when people say, okay. Wow, that was great, I loved that. I enjoy it because I have a voice, which is terrific. I get to meet amazing people, which is fabulous. And if somebody along the way says, Mike, when I came on your show, that launched this for me. Last week, I had a little kid, 16 years old. He sent me an email. Can I come on the show? What do you do? I sing. Oh, okay. I write my own stuff. Even better. Now, he might go on and become a megastar, but I didn't put him on because I thought, yes, I'm helping launch his career. I thought, that'll fill a really good seven-minute segment. Mm.
That's the nature of that job, though. I mean, the people here, like Paris and I, we're in fitness and health and that sort of stuff. And a byproduct of what we do is we get some financial reward from that.
Sure.
So we do that partly for financial reward, but I'm not speaking for you out of turn, Paris, but for me, it's not just that financial reward, which is part of why we do what we do. There's also an exchange of energies with the people that you train. And like I'm helping someone to better a technique or do better form and things like that, and that actually helps me get better in the form and technique that I'm doing too. So if I can do something that helps them, then in turn that actually helps me, and that exchange of energies is very real. And I exchange energies with people in a training environment up to the point where they don't exchange the energy back. Then I go, go on, like I'm not there anymore.
So there's no return?
No, I give it all the time up to a point. And it's like if you're filling someone's jar, and I'm not anyone who's in the spiritual world, and I've read a lot of the books and universal flow of energies and those sorts of things. Like, you can pull energy out from the universe and you can give it to everybody in abundance. Like, we have that fantastic ability to do that. But if that person sucks your energy so quickly and so much and you can't refill it fast enough, then you've got to cut that line. You've got to, you know, I don't want that to do that anymore. And that becomes that energy-sucking thing.
There's so much energy in the room at the moment. We're going to have to take a very short break. And when we come back, I'm going to ask two very important questions. One is that after you've given a lot of help, do you feel some resentment for that person not acting on that help? And secondly, should your help be given away freely? We'll be back in a very short time. Welcome back, everyone. You're with the Point TV. The topic for the day is, why do we feel the need to help people? Now, just before the break, I asked the important question around, after you help someone and they don't follow through with the suggestions, advice, or a bit of coaching and mentoring that you've given them, do you feel a sense of resentment? So I want to turn to you, Ash. I've seen some of your Facebook posts, and I love the way that you do your Facebook Live, and you're doing your Ash in 60 seconds. Do you think anyone listens?
Oh, not necessarily, but that's why I tend to be a clown. But, you know, on the whole resentment thing, I got to a point, like, I was always dirty in my life if someone didn't listen to me and follow through, but, like, that's why I do the posts like I do, because now I just realise sometimes people are just monkeys. So if you're going to train a monkey, it needs to learn by the way you teach it. Otherwise, you can't do anything. So you give up the resentment. Otherwise, you're the only one that carries the guilt. Sometimes people are just like that. You know, you've got to let monkeys be monkeys.
But how far do you take it before you just go, you know what, I'm actually helping these people out because they've asked for it. Not that you're offering it freely. They've asked for it and they said, I want you to give me a hand with this. But they don't follow through on any of the suggestions that you make.
Well, like, the moment you stop enjoying your life, like the moment you stop being happy, the moment these ladies stop being their own version of beautiful and gorgeous, the moment you stop being a man, then game over, baby. You know what I mean? Like, if you're going to help people, people want help, and you can put all the actions in place. Like, I can work with people with mental health issues and go, like, work on your hydration, your diet, your nutrition, learn how your metabolism and immune system and lymphatic system works. And I can give them all the points. If they don't go and research that and come back and say, hey, like, I learned this great thing about my lymphatic system and how my body removes toxins and how that relates to depression. If they don't want to come back to me with that, it's like, you know, you're just throwing pebbles in the pond, baby. Like, you've just got to let the ripples go out and let it go, because otherwise your whole energy, your whole life force, your whole enjoyment, the quality of enjoyment with your mates, with the ladies in your life, just goes out the door. Because why? Because you're like trying to fish for mulloway and you're getting blowfish.
So Jenny, do you give away your helpfulness for free?
Yes, I do.
And the reason?
And the reason is because if I have the opportunity to touch someone's life, that's wonderful.
And
if
you
it
do.
Doesn't, it doesn't matter. I deal with a lot. The last subject was with suicide. I have a lot of people contact me. I go offline with them usually because they can be anywhere in the world, and I will talk on the telephone sometimes for hours. I never meet them. I never have a discussion with them again necessarily.
So you have
it's not important.
You have a generous spirit. Is that what you're saying?
You've got
a generous spirit.
I think I do. I hope I do.
At what stage? And it's not a reflection on you or anyone in this room here, but at what stage do you reach 80, 90, 95, 97? You go, I've had it. I've done with this. I've helped so many people out and nothing has come back my way. Is that going to happen to you? And I know that's kind of hypothetical.
No, I don't believe it will. I would hope it would never, because what I do, I do it because I'm doing my work. I do it because it's what I'm on this earth plane to do.
But what's
it's
the
not
point
about money.
Of using your skill and knowledge and your resources that you have, and you're giving your generosity, you're giving it away for free. And yet we do know there's many people out there who are actually charging a huge fee for the same sort of
help. And I will charge fees for other things, not for that necessarily. No, not for that. And I believe I have got the knowledge and the I would like to think, wisdom. As a result, that's been God-given to me. Well, so that is my gift that I am given to give
for
nothing.
For a lesser value
probably.
Something that is of a high value.
Yeah, but what is the value of community?
Well, you ask the question, answer it.
Yeah. Hey, hang on, I asked the question. Hey, hang on.
But I'm hearing two conversations here, because one seems to be a commercial conversation and one seems to be a just giving of ourselves.
If somebody is coming to me for coaching or mentoring or counselling, yes, they come to me for that. But if people come to me, as happens with social media, and I'm big with social media, I have 38 social media sites, so I'm very spread out there, which means that I have contact with a lot of people, most of whom I'm never going to meet. And if I can make a difference to their day or their life or their suffering, why can't I give up? We've got 24 hours a day.
I got you. I want to know, how does it serve you? What's your payoff for doing this?
Totally.
My payoff is that I know I've changed someone's life. Or maybe supported someone in the change of their life, because we can only do it for ourselves. I can't do it for anyone other than be an ear, maybe give them some support and help. If they use that, that's wonderful. If they don't, that's okay. I don't hold anything on that.
Does that cost you financially, Jenny?
Quite often. More often than not, but that doesn't matter.
So
then you might be in financial help.
Oh, could be quite easily. But that's not... I don't do it for that gain. Because whether I see the person...
So you do it just to feel good?
I feel... If I know I've made a difference... Well, in my heart, I know whether I make a difference or not. But I have something that I have a process I go through every night and every evening, what I'm going to do in that day and whether I've completed that. So my life is all about helping others change their lives if they want my support and help. So I don't look at it. I will give anyone time, as Ash knows, or a few people here know. I don't have a... I'm happy to give what...
Okay, let me put it this way. If I came to you and you said, Gerald, how's things going? And I go, look, I'm struggling in my business. I'm not achieving the goals that I would like to achieve. Mm-hmm. And then you say to me, what? You would say...
I would say to you, is there any way I can help you? Would you like to have a cup of coffee and chat about it?
Right, and then I'll say...
I will do a chat with you, and then you can say, yes, I want you to work with me, or I just want to chat.
You just said help, and I go, yep, I do need your help. I need an injection of about $140,000 worth of cash.
I would then talk to you about what it was you wanted to do and then looking for the people.
You're not helping me.
Well, I am helping you I'd be looking for the people who could help you. I am not qualified to help you in that area, but I know enough people that I can...
You asked the question. You said, how can I help you? And I said, I need $140,000 worth of cash. I need it today. And you go, I can't do that. Now what you've done is you've reneged on your helping.
No, but
Mel,
maybe...
You take
no,
on?
I...
You're a person
that.
Who helps a lot of people.
I help
you're
a lot
the,
of
you're
people.
You're in the dating industry. You're a yeah. wing girl. You like to help people find their true love.
Yep.
How's it working for you?
It's working great.
Right. How's it working for them?
It's working great. And this is why. I'm not attached to their outcome. I give the support that my skills are trained to do. And what they do, whether they take action on it, is not my responsibility. I can hold them accountable if that's what we have agreements for. Mm. But the coaching, whether it's free or paid, has to be given from a place of self-awareness that is then shared for them to take action on if it's the right thing for them.
But you're a classic example. Mel is a classic example of going on to 70 failed dates. Correct?
Yeah.
Well, let's just put it out there. You went on 70 failed dates. Mm-hmm. So you're coming from a place of failure to then help other people succeed.
Well, the girl's got to kiss a lot of frogs to find the prince, doesn't she?
Who was doing the kissing? Speak for yourself.
No, but in reality, this is what I'm looking at. What I'm looking at here is that the people that seem to, and this is just from my research here, is the people that seem to be helping other people come from a place of hurt.
Yep.
They come from a place of wound. They come from a place of failure. And because I've failed, and because I've come from a place of woundedness, I'm now having the authority to be able to show you how not to make the mistakes that I've made. Is that where you're coming from?
Beautiful. Perfect. Because
why would I want to employ somebody like you who's failed 76 times?
Because then I've mastered it. Through the failing, I have learned everything I need to know to be resolute and come from a place of self-mastery in that area, the only area I counsel on, the only area I consult
from. There is nothing like practice, Gerald. There is nothing that beats practice. Practice makes perfection.
But it's not... I'll actually challenge you.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't.
Sorry about the sexual...
John Eels, the great rugby coach, said practice doesn't make perfect. It's perfect practice makes perfect.
Correct.
Yes, sir.
It's the actions you take from the practice. It's the lessons you learn.
It's true.
So that's why I don't have an attachment. It's like, it's up to you to take the action. Here's the help. Whether it's advice, whether it's tools, resources, and now it's up to you to take the action.
Well,
and
okay.
I'm not attached to whether that does or doesn't work for them.
So people probably have to come, probably some people might have to hit rock bottom before they can actually progress and become someone or something.
From a self, my position, that's where I came from. And that allows me to be...
I've just got about 10 answers in my head right
yeah,
now.
It allows me to be confident that I have been through there, from there... to here, and I've experienced everything in between, and these are the lessons, my insights and my wisdom that I share in my niche.
There's no point giving advice to somebody who doesn't want it.
Who said they didn't want it? I don't...
Generalisation.
Yeah. Unsolicited advice is not helpful.
And
either.
It doesn't matter because, as Mel says, you know, having invested interest, you're going to hurt yourself.
And
I'll use the word support rather than help. When I put anything out there, I'll always write... how can I support you? Because if it's not me personally, there will be somebody I know who can do the supporting. I don't like the word help particularly. Totally. We are supporting each other to be the best we can be. And that's what life is all about.
Otherwise, it feels like someone's trying to throw a blanket over you and go, come on, you've got to go this way. You're like, no, I don't want to go that way.
When you're helping, you're saying that I see the word help can be quite a negative word.
So when you were talking about giving people information on the lymphatic system, etc., is that paid or free help?
Both.
Both, okay. Yeah, because it makes a difference if it's a commercial relationship to a helping...
I spent 3 months with a guy who was dealing with mental health issues and gave him all the information under the sun, week in, week out. We spoke about the same information. He couldn't remember nothing. In the end, I had to say, you know what, we can't do this anymore, and he didn't want to keep doing it. 6 months later, he started getting it. That was, like, for me, that was like, oh, I started crying and shit. But it was beautiful, but I can't keep ramming that down someone's throat that doesn't want to understand it, doesn't want to comprehend it, doesn't want to process it and put it into their...
You're having an attachment to what they should be doing. You're having... an objection, an agenda, and an expectation on what somebody should be doing with your opinion. I'm sorry, but it's your opinion, your advice, your perspective.
Physical health is mechanical.
But if they can't act in it, you've got to give it up. You put it out there.
That's what I just
and
said.
And it's for them. I'm agreeing. And you've got to let that go and give up the agenda and the intention behind.
And it's all timing. Everything is timing. What is right today for one is not right for another. We come to it when we're ready to come and we have the awareness and enough awareness to recognise we need that.
And to jump on what you were saying earlier, if I may, sometimes just putting a seed out there, that's why we do free advice, because we know we have things that people want to hear from us, then it's up to them and that seed gets planted. Yeah. And I don't need to know the ripple effects. I don't need to know the changes made. I'm just doing what feels right energetically, and therefore I don't get tired.
So Gerald raised a really good point about resentment. Mm. So if it's something that I'm not getting paid for, that would be my test. Would be my thing I live by is give the gift, no strings attached.
That's right.
So if it's a gift that I give to someone, no strings. But I also do the other thing too, accept the gift, no strings attached.
Nice.
So I'm always checking for resentment inside me. And if I'm feeling resentment, like the tiniest bit of that coming up, then I ask, what do I need to do to change that relationship or the transaction between us, because it's all about transactions, or do I need to just step back from that?
Or are
That's
we judging?
That's empowered feminine right there.
But it's how much attachment and judgment you should be doing this. Like you're saying, you can get frustrated. Well, why should they? Do you have all the answers? Not you personally, does
Yeah,
one.
You're right.
So I'm going to explain all of that. So your suffering, Viktor Frankl, spoke of you need meaning for your suffering. Mm. So you had 70 really shit dates. And the only way you're going to get meaning out of that is by doing something about it. Mm. So from Aristotle, the voids, you had a void, you fulfilled that void. The best way to come to terms with your pain is by telling people, I'm shit at dates, let me tell you how to do it. All right? So you just flipped it on the head, which is pretty opposite. Your practice makes permanent, okay? So whatever someone practices is what becomes permanent. So if you've got someone who's been depressed for 20 years, obese for 20 years, addicted for 20 years, in 6 months, they're not going to shift it, okay?
Yeah, of course.
It's 6 months of going to the gym, you're not going to undo 30 years of bad behavior. You'll start a process, undoubtedly, and that's why all of a sudden you think you've quit, but the subconscious is already sort of still ticking over back there. So practice is permanent. And as far as financial advice, go and see an accountant. You can get a self-managed fund, get a director and a trustee, and that can get you 140 grand.
You're saying this is a plastic example.
And this is helping.
Yeah, plastic example. I didn't ask for his help.
One thing.
It's all unsolicited. So let's just go to science. It's the whole thing. You're unsolicited help. As if she's sitting here listening to what you're saying.
Okay, I just got on a science fact. On a science fact.
Oh, this would be good.
This is an opinion. This is actual fact. You can go get
if you're going to say it, get it right.
Roll it out, baby.
That's the one. Okay, so if you actually go and get one of those, you'll find you can actually... there's no such thing as a psychic. You can just go get one of those tests, and they'll tell you exactly proportionally what your brain is. So you can
Tom Cruise? You know psychiatry. You can tell me exactly what my brain's going to function.
I can tell potentially what you're... So if your frontal lobe is decreased, then there's a good chance you're going to be psychotic. Okay? It's a known fact. If you actually take tests of children that have frontal lobe development, poor frontal lobe development, they end up being psychotic. So if you look at the right hemisphere of the brain, if I damage this part of your brain, you're inclined to think you need big boobs, you need a bigger vehicle, maybe you just believe in God, okay?
Why do you need to help everybody?
If you have...
We don't need your opinion yet.
If you
we
have...
We want your opinion.
Down in
if
front!
If you have... So you've got the hippocampus's memory, amygdala, okay? So
well,
you've got this set of testicles... This set of testicles basically in the back of your brain. If they're enlarged by about 8%, you're inclined to help people.
Did I hear you right? You've got testicles in the back of your
brain.
Hang on a minute. Say that again.
So you've got amygdala, which is two little round things in the back of your brain, about yay big.
Yeah.
If they're enlarged by 8%,
yeah.
you're inclined to help people.
But what's the link to testicles?
That's what they look like.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what I'm getting at is you think there's this consciousness in you that makes you want to help people.
Yeah.
It's actually the parts of your brain are enlarged. If you have a massive hippocampus,
it's
so
actually
Einstein
no link to testicles at all. It's just,
no,
I was
it's
enjoying
just
that interaction there. It was lovely.
Nah, not
yeah.
really bad.
We have to take a very quick break because I tell you what, the conversation was quite intelligent until Drew got in there. So when we come back from the...
Things getting heavy around here.
When we come back from the break, I'm going to ask this more important question is, does change really only happen when a person wants it? Be back right from there. Well, didn't that get heated just before there? Welcome back, I'm Gerald Porschman, and you're with The Point TV. Just before the break, I asked the even more important question, that does change only happen when people want it? And I want to turn to you, Paris, first, because you're a person who delivers and helps and gives people maybe strategies and advice and coaching around health and fitness. I mean, look at you. You're a bloody Adonis.
Oh, it's a T-shirt.
Woo! It's a T-shirt. It's a T-shirt. I've got to get one of those T-shirts.
I did give you one a long time ago.
Ouch. Ouch. All right, so what I want to ask is that you're probably in the same position as David here, is where you where people come to you for help. They say, look at me, I need a transformation. Do you sometimes feel a sense of failure when that person hasn't gone through with the program to the expectations that you required them to go through? Is there any accountability on you?
Probably when I first started my business. Obviously, when you start a business, you want to be successful. So the advice and the probably the experience that you give them, you think it's probably the best that you'd be able to give them because obviously that's how I became the way I am. But if it didn't work, you kind of think back on, like, what did I do wrong? How could I change it to get the message through? So over the years, like, I've sort of come to the realization that you can only give so much to someone who wants it. And if it doesn't, well... doesn't mean you can palm them off, because I've got clients that come back 2-3 years down the track that come back for what they've probably missed 2-3 years. It might not be the right time for them.
I guess so. Where you're coming from, like, people watching this would probably say we're like a mirror image of each other. Because you were when you first started off your business 10, 12 years ago,
yeah.
I was not one of your first, but I was there. So did you feel a little bit like a sense of failure that you couldn't get me to... push through and finish? That's interesting.
When I look at a potential client, I always look at their background, work-wise, family-wise. I look at the whole picture rather than what they actually probably would need health-wise, because I know from experience that depending on your hours, work-wise, family-wise, it's very hard to fit something else into your daily life. So
you actually make excuses for other people?
I probably can.
Yeah, so you made an excuse for me. I looked at your background, your history. I saw the amount of work that you were doing or not doing.
Yep.
I get it. You're making an excuse for me. That's interesting. Nicole, so you're in the hot and healthy area.
Yes, baby.
So you're giving, and I've heard your podcast and we've had a chat together. Mm-hmm. You feel a sense of gratification when... you can transform a person from eating unhealthy to healthy, from mind thinking negative to positive?
It's definitely a sense of satisfaction, but I don't take ownership of their outcomes. I'll take them through a process, but I can't be attached to the outcomes. I can't monitor what they're eating. I can't make thought choices for them on a daily basis.
But that's your job.
No.
That's your job. That's what you do.
I think the question answers that itself, isn't it? You know, like, if when we train and you give dietitian a dietary advice, and I teach people how to do a block and a punch, and Paris teaches them how to do a bicep curl, the technique is the technique. They're going to change if they want to change. And it doesn't matter what we put in behind the strategies and ideas and processes. And let's go through the spiritual journey of you getting from here to there. Mm. If they don't want to walk that path, they're not going to walk the path.
Yes,
it doesn't matter what we do with it. We can direct physically how to get someone stronger. Mm. And this is how you do a bicep curl, and this is how you make this happen. And they go, yeah. Oh, okay. This is great.
And
they walk
changed.
Out and they go, that just is all too bloody hard. And the same as giving advice about the spiritual journey, and a lot of us are on that spiritual journey, and you do a lot with people over 50. I'm there, I come and see you. Actually, I'm not a woman. It's all right. Don't go
That's
there.
That's all right, I can deal with you.
Yeah. So as you go through that journey, the path is only going to change when you want to get off it and start another one. That's just, the question answers itself.
But let me ask, and I'm going to go and look at everyone, and I will get to you, Di, because you're one of these like anomalies out there. That I've read your book, and I've heard your story, and I know a lot about you. And I would love to ask each person that's also come up here, have you all come from a place of hurt, or have you all come from a place of wounded that's got you to where you are?
Absolutely.
Were you, for you, were you bashed as a little kid?
No, but...
Were you a bully?
Only to you, mate.
Yeah, good. Yeah. But for you also, were you tormented as a child that now got you to where you are? I want to know the rise of... what makes us great helpers?
Oh, well, I grew up pretty much in a domestic violence family. It's been pretty, it's pretty normal in our sort of
culture.
Heritage, culture. I obviously didn't like that lifestyle. So obviously, maybe depending on my profession, it's probably a way of maybe looking at people's hurt and trying to regain their confidence through the way I've done it.
And you express that well. Come from a place of hurt. Mm. And so you're now going, I don't want other people to come and experience the same as what I've experienced. You've come from an amazing place of hurt also. Like, I'm using the word amazing as if it's a great word. But you've come from a place of real wound.
Yeah.
And why you're doing what you're doing. Why do you do it?
I think a pivotal thing, getting back to change, was when all of those losses happened... A coach / colleague said to me, "Does it hurt enough yet?" And I got it. Mm. And practically her next sentence was, "You're too fucking nice, Pat Armitstead." Mm. You know, you've got this life of being so effing nice.
But isn't that a great quote? If you want to turn your friends into an enemy, you give them advice that they don't want to hear.
Yeah, so true.
Isn't that so true?
Sure.
So is that what happened to you?
I think I was, 16 years nursing, the helping profession, delivering into that and feeling I'm doing good, so I'm feeling good.
Yeah.
And I did, genuinely. And then even when I went into another role, I still delivered into community, and I still, even through to now, that's one aspect of my life where I find deep fulfilment. In that contribution, I love words like being a balm and being a salve. Mm. I'm like ointment, if you like. But I know the wound is deeper, and the change has to come from within.
Okay, so let me ask you this: Is it just again through my own research? I have found that people who continue to tell their story haven't healed themselves. And there seems to be this get up on the stage. I mean, I watched a bit of YouTube last night, and I saw, a bit of that Idol and X Factor, and everyone's got a sad story. You know, the guy that stutters, he's now a comedian. The person that comes from a place of wound, she's now a great singer. It's like, if we haven't told our story on the wild stage, then we're nothing. Then we're absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
And so yours, for example, you come from an incredible wounded place. Mm-hmm. And so now you're giving suggestions, advice, coaching to women over 50, confidence beyond 50. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Right. Is it too late for a 50-year-old? If they haven't worked it out now at 50,
No, it's not. No. I think that when you get to that stage, it's suddenly like when you hit 50, it's... that's when everything happens. Relationships break down, spouses drop off the end of the earth, children leave home, relationships break down all over, you lose a job, you become bankrupt, blah, blah, blah. And it's when all of those things happen together, you go, when?
Yeah.
Because you've spent a life of covering and then moving through and becoming successful in whatever area.
How many times do you, when you coach a person, tell your story? When you're coaching a person who's wanting help and advice, how many times do you go and tell them your story of wound?
Oh, yeah, that's probably true because they...
So why
well,
do you
most
do that?
Of them would know that before they come to me.
Because maybe they've read your book.
Yeah, if they've come from that place, I don't need to retell it because they know where it is that I'm coming from. But it's amazing how I've changed. 10 years ago when I wrote the book, I thought that was the end of my journey.
Because you've all told me your story.
You know, I thought it was the end of my journey.
You've all told me your story.
But it was actually the beginning.
I don't know your story. Well, you haven't told
Once upon a time.
But you have to take responsibility for yourself.
But you asked me.
To that point.
Sorry?
You asked me. I didn't tell you.
Oh, that's right.
10 years ago, my mom. Yeah. So I want to ask Nicole this. So I've got this from Lee Brownless, who had written and said he wanted to be here today. And he said, I'll give you the reasons why people have this need to help people. I want you to pick one, and I want you to elaborate on it. We're selfish. We crave power. We love to feel significantly important. We desire attention. We have to be in control and in control of others. We chase money. We long to be superior to others. We seek validation. We have the need to belong, and we want to be able to express our sexuality without shame. That's his reasons. Now, I reckon he's just gone to Google and Googled it and come up with 10, mate.
Well, I'm going to grab the significance one.
Okay, but he did write one thing, and I want you to add to this one here. He said this. Lee, this is for you. You wrote, I love the power it gives me. If I'm on camera or coaching someone or presenting to a group, there is no one that is more powerful in the room at that time than me.
I'm going to call bullshit on that. And I'm going to say from my own perspective, that may be Lee's. Respect to you for being so honest and open. But for me, I get a lot of personal higher vibration payoff energetically, whatever you want to call it, by being in that space with that person and walking their journey with them and guiding them to somewhere that they've given me permission to walk with them. I do it because, yes, there's a financial benefit, but I've done a lot of it for free. I found that when I focused on the financial benefits, I lost my mojo. I didn't attract clients naturally. It was grab, grab, grab instead of attract. When I focused on service, sharing my gifts with that person and being in the space alongside them, not in front of them going, I know everything, listen to me, do what I tell you. But it's in that space of safety and togetherness that you find the solutions. I don't have all the solutions, they do, but I have to help inspire them to recognize the answers within them, bring it out and show them the path. I do it because I get an energetic payoff first. I also do it because I have a big pain story right back to very young days. And I learned a great deal from that. So I'm skilled in a lot of different ways.
And you need to tell your story. You need to tell your pain story.
No. I did in the early days. I told everyone about sexual abuse and about being bullied and about all the different things that happened to me over the time because that was the way I dealt with it as an extrovert. Mm. I needed to get it outside of me in order to understand it, in order to let go of it. But I also used the lessons I learned from that to help others because it made me feel good.
It's kind of weird if I went to a psychologist and the psychologist telling me all about their issues and problems and I go, actually, I came here for your help. Mm. And then you're telling me about all your shit.
Sure.
But I'm just asking... How does this relate to who you are? So, go on.
Just so for that, about what his comment about being on stage and being a coach and having everything come to you, I think, to be realistic about it, I teach martial art against, you know, lots of people who have done it for like 30 years. And I tell my people that if I'm feeling bad and I'm feeling sad and unhappy, I go to training. Because the training energy makes me feel uplifted. So being the coach in front of those people, I go there if I'm having the worst day ever. Mm-hmm. And I go in there putting on the brave face saying, I'm a martial art coach. I need to show you, I need to motivate you, I need you to be able to do this. And as soon as I leave, it's like everything's gone. Mm-hmm. All of the stress and hassle of the day is gone. So, yes, I feed off the people that come to me, energy-wise, not emotionally or spiritually or anything like that. I leave them with a feeling of me being grateful and I give them a boost, and even my worst time I come out feeling better for that. Now, I haven't had a bad upbringing. Yes, it's all relative, isn't it? Oh my God, I stubbed my toe, I got shot by an air rifle, or you know, I hit my brother, or whatever it might have been. To me, that's tragic. Oh man, that was just...
Yeah. At the time.
I shot him in the head, it was great. It was a good shot, but it was tragic. You know, it was only an air rifle, I know you're stuck, but it's all right. You know, the whole idea of the tragedy is all about perspective and mindset and belief. You know, like, your upbringing was horrible, but possibly. But in your heritage, in your life, that was normal. So was it bad? Or is it only bad because we say it's bad today? Like, if you were in that heritage and that lifestyle for your whole life, you would think nothing different of it. So we're all the byproduct of our environment and our history and our stories. I'm sort of one that goes, that's a really bad story. I'm really sorry for you. I won't have that happen to me. So I don't have to experience the journey of suffering to know what suffering's like. I can get it from other people.
So, and I think that's part of the learning from the history and being able to, at this level here and now, be able to intervene or create something that's a trigger for someone else not to have to do.
It's good that you say that. I'm gonna ask Mike Bennett to come back on here, because Mike runs a very successful radio show, and Mike and I have had this discussion about people that are coming on, and they're coming from a place of wound. So I'll ask him in a moment. But there's a lot of sad stories out there, and it seems like to me that there's a lot of sad stories and a lot of people needing help out there. And I want to be able to know, you know, what's happened to society today that says that there's so much hurt out there. I'm going to give the last word to David, because I know he's itching to say something, but we've got to take a short break and then wrap it up with the final few words from... do we have sponsors here?
Yeah.
No sponsors.
Yeah.
Not
Point
one
TV. Just really quick on that. The whole idea of doing what we do and helping people, and it seems to be, from my experience, that the most of the helpers out there had needed the most amount of help when they were growing up. Like, they've suffered, they've needed more. There's this drive and motivation for them to go, you know, shit, I suffered in my life and I don't want anyone else to do it. But really, without disrespect to anyone in their journeys and their suffering and their pain, everyone's journey is an individual journey, and the choice of their suffering is theirs. So just because people haven't suffered in their life doesn't mean they can't give the best and the soundest advice to those that potentially feel they have. Like, again, one person's suffering isn't another person's suffering. Like, I might perceive my suffering of stubbing my toe when I was a kid as tragic.
It's pretty relative.
It's totally relative. So do we all need to be the most amount of suffered person and tell my journey, my story, because, man, that's helped me get to where I am today. It's like, well, it doesn't have any relationship to you. Move on. You know, I'll help you because I've done my journey and I've travelled this path, which is nothing as bad as yours, Gerald. I mean, look at the opposites. It's like opposing sides. 10 years of seeing Adonis and has seen... Well, you know what I'm saying. The journey's changed in the varying parts in that.
Yes.
So, again, the opinion, and that's what this is all about, isn't
maybe,
it?
Maybe in our next topic, when we come back next month, we should talk about what drives happiness.
Ooh, nice topic.
When we come back... Yes. When we come back from the break, I've invited Mike Bennett back on, who runs a very successful... radio program, and there's a lot around wanting to help people. So we'll be back right after the short break. Welcome back. Just before the break, I did say I was going to invite Mike back. Mike, you are back. You run a radio show, and you would have to admit on your show... Talk to me. Do you get a lot of people that are offering advice and help in their mind and spirit?
Oh, my goodness. What we used to get, and I've stopped it now, because you know it was really interesting to listen to everybody about the sob stories and the X Factor and all of these things. I don't care if somebody's got a sob story. Can they sing or not? And what they used to do is come on the show and say, oh, I want to share my story with you. Okay. And I was getting manically depressed. I was walking out the studio going like this. I've had enough of it all. And I did a poll with the listeners, and they said, Mike, your show is getting really, it's bringing us down. And I'm not saying everybody has to come on and be happy clappy all the time, but I think we reach a saturation point of our sympathy and empathy kind of wears out. Mm. And if you want to be entertained, you watch TV, you listen to the radio, you don't want doom and gloom all the time. Mm. And it's also really interesting just listen to other panelists talking about their story. I don't have one. And I'm writing my book, and I'm thinking, I've got nothing bad. We were brought up in Glasgow. One or two of the audience members know what that's like.
That was the bad part.
But growing up in Glasgow, we didn't know that we were poor until we went to England and saw people that had money. But it didn't make any difference because we felt we were being very well looked after. We didn't go without. So I'm writing my book thinking, nobody's going to cry over this because there's nothing sad in it. But that's not a bad thing.
Yeah. Sean, you've been listening to a lot of this, mm-hmm. and I've been seeing you down there, and it's like you wanted to run up and get sat in the hot seat.
Okay. Yeah. When you were talking about sad stories, yeah. and you mentioned earlier about people helping from a place of wound, I feel, and I've travelled around Australia a lot raising kids, moving annually if we've got three kids, no family, and I am always volunteering school staff, neighbourhood, community, and I feel the reason I do it is actually from the opposite. I feel grateful, and I've had a full life. I've got this capacity. That's why I volunteer, and that's why I help the neighbour who ends up sick or, you know, whatever. So not so much from a place of wound.
So you're coming from abundance.
Yeah, yeah.
You have having plenty to
but share. But then there is that fine point with the resentment. I like that earlier because I can be over generous and then suddenly, you know, someone's moving in and then finding that. The way I feel about it is it makes me feel good. It helps my kids settle. If I'm volunteering in the schools, I'm getting into the community. I'm very social, so I'm making friends.
Yeah,
but I don't really see, besides the fact that some people, that I feel I let myself go too far or some people overstep the boundaries, I don't really see that much of a negative thing in it.
Sally, you do it for selfish reasons, don't you?
Do I really?
Oh, no, I'm just waiting for your response.
It's news to me.
Yeah.
Look, maybe I do it in a way because to me, making a difference, it's my purpose. It's what I'm here to do. I'm here to make the world a better place. And I try and do that in as many.
Who gave you that job?
Me.
Right.
But it's kind of like, I don't have, it's almost like I don't have a choice. It just hit me.
Yes.
It just hit me one day.
And maybe that is selfish.
Yeah.
Because you're just drawn. Like, I can't. Yeah. I have to stop myself. And I was telling Lauren the other day, like, it's the beginning of school term and I have to stop myself from helping the person across the street or helping at school. I have to, I'm compelled to.
Yeah.
But again,
I try to wait till they ask for things like that. Yeah. But
seriously, you know, you're there. And I think it's such an admirable thing that people that want to save, you know, have world peace and, you know, stop the children from starving and do those wonderful, admirable things. But what do you get out of it?
Just exactly that, helping make a difference, knowing that someone, you know, I'm going to start with the business I have, it's fair trade. Mm. So the fact that I have a fair trade business and I buy from people in developing countries and there's families that they can have dinner, they have food on the table and their children go to school, which actually education is a really big thing in helping break the cycle of poverty.
Yeah.
That is a great thing and that's my core business. I make money out of that too.
Yeah.
But I worked in, you know, more corporate things. I was sick of making the rich guys richer, and it was soulless for me. So this is far less lucrative, believe me. But it's for me. I feel a lot better.
So I have a question. Yes. I'm fine to do things for free,
and I had do a lot for free.
I had a corporate background, and maybe a question for you. I had a corporate background, and and then started this travel with the family, and I volunteer, and I massage, and I yoga, and I do yoga classes. A lot of it is for free, very little for money. When it comes to now wanting to build a business, I feel uncomfortable, you know, we're stopping moving, uncomfortable about helping other people because it feels like such a natural spiritual thing and asking money for it. And I just block myself and I just give away my time, my energy.
I completely understand.
Many do.
Yeah.
Many do. The souls, they... Sorry, it's tail. Oh, you need a bit of help. That thing that, I don't have a lot, so others may not have a lot.
Yeah.
And so I'm not looking for a lot.
Yeah.
When everyone says, oh, you've got to look for a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So what is a lot?
Yeah.
What's enough? You know, what are you happy
with? My granny used to say, I wish you enough. And I never understood. As a kid, I used to say, no, I want a bike. Never mind enough, because I didn't get it. But I kind of get that now.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. How are you going to separate? So when people say, oh, can you do a massage? You think, well, that's part of my business. Mm. How are you going to separate the business from the giving side? No. I asked you the question. How are you going to separate them?
Yeah, and I think that's it. Separate them. Yeah. Say these things I do as my business, these things I do for free to give away and that kind of thing. So you might say you do massage, you do yoga, you do that sort of thing.
Some people do that as part of their sales funnel. They'll set up 5-day video webinar thing, suck everyone in and get down to the bottom and say, here's the killer, thanks very much. Mm. So that's a pretty standard approach. We see it all the time.
But that's not what you're saying you'll do. You're not saying you'll give something for free and then next time you come, it's $100 or whatever.
No, it's separating them.
Yeah. From the start.
Can you just ask the question? So if somebody said to me, Gerald, I'd love you to help me with some video or with yourself, don't you ask the question, is this a freebie or am I invoicing you?
No, I just assume now, because we don't do any of that for free anymore, I assume, it's a business. So here's what we charge, here's the hourly rate. We've become very transparent in what we do. We post our prices on the website so people know, these guys do this and that's how much it costs.
Yeah.
To get away from all of that, it's Mike, we've been on this show, he'll do me a freebie or a cheapie. No.
So maybe it's the nature of the work.
Absolutely.
Good. Okay, just want that.
Yeah, straight.
So not only running a business. Invoicing people, you go and ask people about what's your budget, and they come up and they go, I've got to have a budget. You know,
I do know.
Yes, I know. And so that becomes a real issue.
So, Jeff, you've been listening to all this. And
I have.
I've been seeing this out there and people whispering. Yeah, I hate a person with notes. I love a person with notes. What's your take on this, final take?
Well, what's happening is, firstly, you're saying that helping is bad.
You said that.
I don't think you've been saying that.
That's the undertone that's come through with what people have been talking about. It's a case of...
Okay, yeah.
Why do we feel the need to help? So there's been a lot of talk about the need to help, very little talk about feeling the need to help. And what happens is when you feel the need to help, if you're feeling something, if you've got to try and get in there, I'm compelled to do this, this is what I really want to do. So what you've had is value shift. Mm-hmm. Your values were aligned with this, making money, doing this, being that. Your values are now aligned with this, being this. So you can't pull those two values together because they don't correlate. So you're going to have to say, I'm going to do this for money and this for free.
Yeah. Mm.
And keep your values together. So if you look at our sense of values is like a globe of the earth. You can't look at every country at once. So you can't express every value at once. Every value you hold can be expressed at a different time. Doesn't mean you don't have that value anymore. It just means that currently I need to focus on this value, which is the value of giving. Now I need to focus on this value, which is the value of making money and being worth my time.
Mm-hmm.
So when you start giving away your values, you start devaluing yourself, mm-hmm. which is business do it all the time.
Mm.
It's what they talk about. So what I've seen a lot of is that the undertone is that that helping becomes a negative thing. So if we didn't have helping, we wouldn't have nurses, we wouldn't have teachers, we wouldn't have firemen, we would have none of us sitting here because we're all helping in some degree to somebody.
But they get paid for it. Nurses?
Oh, I'm pretty sure Danny does a lot for free.
Nurses, firemen, police.
But you don't go into those without having some draw to it, right? You don't go, I'm going to make $1 million being a copper. Because you won't. So you have to be drawn into some might if they're on the grift, you know.
The undertone for me was what was the payoff?
Right.
That's the question I was asking. What do you get out of it?
Can I just jump in? Sure. Just think back to 2 weeks ago what happened in Melbourne. It was awful. That crazy guy, Mordaunt, murdered people. Every single person in the street wanted to do something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you guys, the psychologists, talk about fight, flight, freeze. You don't know how you're going to react. But we saw amazing acts of human compassion. Mm. They didn't think about it. They didn't want anything for it. They did it. Oh, my God, look, people are in trouble. So that's different. I think that the human instinct just takes over. You're not thinking about the payoff. Oh, will I get on Nine News tonight?
No.
Interesting, people were criticizing the people that were using the mobile phones in the street.
Mm.
Again, their brain might have just hijacked them. Oh, my God, I can't get too close, but I need to record this. So people were quite critical of that. But
then you got 3 or 4 days later where somebody started to or wanted to capitalise on that and started putting up signs about free hugs. Let's give free hugs. And then, by the way, here's my business.
Yeah.
You know, and so that's where I now go. What is your pay? Why are you doing this from a place of hurt? You're now out there saying, here's my business. And by the way, let's do a free hug. That's where I draw the line. And if you're saying...
Well, that's not helping.
That's not helping. That's but marketing. for them, what they're doing in their mindset, yep. You know this, Jeff, what they're doing yep. is that they're saying, I'm out there now offering my emotional help by saying, here, we're all one, I'll give you a hand with this. But really, in the back of their mind, they're not thinking that at all. They're thinking about, I'm going to get as many likes and clicks and maybe prop my business up.
So really what you've got is a whole heap of good answers to the wrong question.
God, give me the right question. We'll do this all over again.
You should be asking, why do people continue to help when it's detrimental to someone else? So why am I helping when you've said, no, I've had enough help, I don't need any help now, yet I feel compelled to continue to help? So when you've got a compulsion to help, or a compulsion that I want to go out there and do this and make money out of it, that's someone's actually now, it's not about helping now, it's about, we all say selfish, but selfish isn't bad. Selfish, if we weren't selfish, then we wouldn't be doing half this stuff. So so it's not about good or bad. It's about that this person wants to be out there and they want to make money off this. So they're seeing an opportunity, of course, and they're using it. So you're really looking at, when does helping get to a point where it's detrimental to both the person that's helping and the helpee? That's where you've got to be asking, what's going on there?
And the thing is that we've had something like... I don't know, when you look at the collective experience around this room here, we've probably got 500-600 years of, great knowledge of resources out here. And what I wanted to do was just raise the question, and this, you know, this will continue. As soon as we shut the cameras down, I'm sure that this will continue on. When we come back the next time, we have got another topic for you, and I think we probably just touched on it. What we want to do is we want to ask the question, and you're all invited to come here at the Point TV here in Brisbane, and the question will be is, how much happiness do we really need, and is there such a thing as in pursuit of happiness? Until then, I want you to thank all of my guests here. You'll see them up on the credits. We'll see you next time on the Point TV.